Welcome back to another trip with the Knights along the Mobius Strip.
This is the final video. Well, don't worry, there'll be plenty of more videos coming up. But well, this is the final video of our introductory triad, in which we started to explore the beauty of mathematics through sequences and spirals present in nature. If you haven't watched the previous videos, head down to the description. You'll find the links in there. Anyways, let's move on to today's topic, which you'll doubtlessly find super exciting. No more dilly-dallying. Well, to be precise, let's move on to the principal statement of today's topic.
Did you know that the number of steps or divisions in the Euclidean algorithm never exceeds 5 times the number of digits in the lesser number?
Wait, what? How does this even connect to our previous videos where we elaborately discussed Fibonacci numbers? And Euclid's algorithm? Definitely not what we expected. If these are your thoughts presently, bear with us for some time, and I assure you that everything will fall into place. It won't be long before you connect the dots and see that the Fibonacci numbers are indeed intricately connected to this theorem. Let us not take a giant leap though, lest we end up on a different cross-section of the Klein bottle rather than the Mobius strip we are currently moving on.
Algorithms, a set of instructions resembling a pseudocode that at the end of the day helps us solve a problem, trivial or complicated. And in today's digital era, algorithms occupy a pivotal position whether you consider cryptography or artificial intelligence. And in fact, algorithms are not crucial to computing alone. It's essentially a part of our daily actions. Think of it, you wanna solve the Rubik's Cube? You follow algorithms. When you are cooking, the recipe you are following is a high-level algorithm. And it's fascinating to note that even some music compositions are made through use of mathematical models and algorithms, such as Markov chains and Gaussian distributions. And definitely, we all follow strict algorithms on the monochrome checkered chessboard.
In fact, simple arithmetic operations, whether you consider addition or division, are also algorithms. Well, algorithms definitely isn't our primary focus in this video, though we would love to explore this topic solely in a separate video sometime soon. But let's look a little more closely into these elementary arithmetic algorithms.
Let's talk about division. You all learned the rules of division in elementary school. The way in which you were introduced to the concept may have varied, of course. Perhaps it was fractions, or perhaps using manipulations to separate n objects into p piles. You started out like this. Nevertheless, you gradually learned that given two integers a and p, you can express the division algorithm as something akin to this, where q and r are unique and r falls in the given range, a being the dividend, b the divisor, q the quotient and r the remainder.
Talking of remainders, you may or may not be familiar with the concept of congruences, which we briefly touched upon in our previous video, in which we said that A is congruent to B modulo n if both A and B leave the same remainder on division by n. And talking about modulus, modular arithmetic is brilliant when it comes to finding the remainders when dealing with pretty large dividends in exponential form, as shown in this wonderful video by Zach Starr. Link in the description. Oh well, back to elementary school. So, you learned about division in your early days, and eventually you were also introduced to the concept of composite and prime numbers. Composite numbers having factors other than one in themselves, factors being integers that divided those numbers without leaving a remainder. And as for prime numbers, they have been a source of fascination for human comprehension ever since the ancient days of establishing the early grounds of number theory. Their appearances are bizarre, as you can see in Euler's product formula for the Riemann zeta function. Their distribution is a mystery, in fact, You can win $1,000,000 if you can solve the Riemann hypothesis, a problem dealing with the zeros of the zeta function that thus closely relates to the distribution of primes, which just comes out as a consequence of the hypothesis.
Oh well, enough of our ramblings on number theory. Excuse the enthusiasm, my friend, that we feel once we get started with this branch of pure mathematics. So you learnt about division, and you also learnt about factors in your childhood days. And then, around the same time, you also learnt about the greatest common divisor, or GCD. Say you have a 24 by 32 rectangular lawn, and you wish to tessellate it with carpet grass, which is available in the market as flat square pieces. Now, the bigger the squares, the lesser the price as compared to the price of many smaller squares, adding up to have the same area due to certain factors like cutting cost, etc. So it is more efficient for you to buy such squares of carpet grass with maximum possible dimensions such that n of these squares fit in the lawn perfectly, without leaving any space empty and without overlapping. You realize that the length of the side of such a square would in fact be the GCD of the lengths of the two sides of the rectangular lawn, and in this case it is 8.
So again, back in school, you may have learned to find the GCD using factorization, which becomes tedious when it gets to bigger and bigger numbers, or by recursive division involving the remainder obtained in each step. The second method is basically nothing other than Euclid's algorithm. The Euclidean algorithm for finding the GCD of, say, M and N is thus nothing other than this familiar process of iterated long division, which can be written as the follows. The process holds when a remainder 0 is obtained, and then the GCD of M and N is the divisor RK in the last step of division. This isn't the only algorithm established by Euclid to find GCDs. In another procedure, he put forth that if we obtain the difference of the two numbers and replace the larger number with this difference and continue the same process in subsequent steps until the residue equals the difference in the last step, the residue or difference thus obtained in this final step is the GCD of the two numbers taken initially.
It is immediately evident, however, that the second algorithm requires more steps than the original algorithm. In case of Euclidean algorithm by subtraction, the number of steps can be linear. For example, for the GCD calculation of x and 1, you would need to subtract the smaller number 1 from the bigger number x, and then from x minus 1, and then from x minus 2, on and on until you are finally left with 1. This example is the worst case possibility. In case of Euclidean algorithm by division, however, we can find out that the time complexity is logarithmic, and it is precisely in proving this that we shall discover Fibonacci numbers come into play, which brings us to the statement we introduced towards the start of the video.
The number of steps or divisions in the Euclidean algorithm never exceeds 5 times the number of digits in the lesser number. This is actually the statement of Gabriel Lame's theorem, the theorem with the very first application of Fibonacci numbers. Lame was a French mathematician, and among his other contributions in the field of mathematics are his mathematical theory of elasticity, use of curvilinear coordinates to add to the theory of partial differential equations, and other works. However, his running time analysis of the Euclidean algorithm is notable in the sense that it marks the beginning of computational complexity theory.
It's remarkable that he proved this theorem in the 19th century, way back in 1844.
Oui, oui, mon ami. And now, in the present, in one of the most disastrous years of the 21st century, let us make an attempt at understanding the proof. The approach here is the one given by Hunsberger or Sierpinski. Suppose you need to calculate the GCD of two numbers, a n plus 1 and a n, where an is the smaller number and it takes n steps where n is greater than 1. By the Euclidean algorithm, you can see that we have the following. The GCD of an plus 1 and an is the last non-zero remainder obtained, that is a1. Since the numbers involved here are all natural numbers, they are at least 1. However, note that q1 cannot be 1, as that would imply a2 equals a1, which contradicts the inequality in the previous step. So Q1 is at least 2.
Now we need to proceed back up the stairs. We have A1 greater than equal to 1 and Q1 greater than equal to 2, giving A2 which is equal to Q1 times A1 greater than equal to 2. Next A3 which is equal to Q2 times A2 plus A1 greater than equal to 3. Note that the quotients other than Q1 can be equal to 1. Proceeding further, we get A4 greater than equal to 5, A5 greater than equal to 8, A6 greater than equal to 13, and so on. Can you see the Fibonacci numbers making their appearance? This pattern continues, and we see that in general, an is greater than equal to fn, where fn is the nth Fibonacci number. The base cases here are a bit different though from the original sequence. Here f1 is defined as 1 and f2 is defined as 2, and the remaining terms are defined by the recurrence relation fn is equal to fn minus 1 plus fn minus 2.
In order to proceed further, we first need to prove the following result. Fn plus 5 is greater than 10fn. You can observe that this is true for the first three Fibonacci numbers, that is f1, f2 and f3. For fn, where n is greater than 4, we have fn equals fn minus 1 plus fn minus 2, and we can break down fn minus 1 further to give us the following, hence ending up with this result. Therefore, for fn plus 5, we can simply write that down as the follows, which finally gives us 21 fn minus 2 plus 13 fn minus 3 in terms of fn minus 2 and fn minus 3, which is clearly greater than 20 fn minus 2 plus 10 fn minus 3, which is actually 10 times fn. Great. We have thus established the result.
This leads to the fact that fn plus 5 has at least one more decimal digit than fn. From the Fibonacci sequence, we can see that the first 5 Fibonacci numbers have a single digit. From the previous result, we can see that the next 5 Fibonacci numbers have at least 2 digits, the next 5 have at least 3 digits, and the next 5 have at least 4 digits. Continuing so on, we have for n greater than equal to 5k and less than equal to 5 times k plus 1, fn has at least k plus 1 digits. Now, if you remember, we had shown that an is greater than equal to fn a while ago. This proves that for n greater than equal to 5k and less than equal to 5 times k plus 1, an too has at least k plus 1 digits. That is, n is less than equal to 5 times k plus 1, which in turn is less than equal to 5 times the number of digits in an, or simply the number of steps in the Euclidean algorithm, that is n, is no more than 5 times the number of digits in an, the smaller number of the pair whose GCD is being calculated.
A corollary of the theorem, proved by Knuth, tells that for 0 less than u less than v less than n, the number of division steps needed by the Euclidean algorithm to process u and v does not exceed c log root 5n to the base 5 minus 2. Sounds quite sophisticated. Here, phi refers to the golden ratio.
As a matter of fact, the estimate in the Lamy's theorem is the best possible. That is, we cannot replace the number 5 in the theorem by any smaller integer. This can be easily seen by considering two consecutive Fibonacci numbers, say GCD of 8 and 13. By the Euclidean algorithm, we can see that this takes 5 steps, that is equal to 5 times the number of digits in the smaller number 8. It should be clear by now that the worst case scenario definitely arises whenever the two numbers are consecutive terms of the Fibonacci sequence. This is because in this case, all the quotients except Q1 turn out to be 1. Note that the numbers need not be consecutive Fibonacci terms for the worst case to arise.
Now, time for something visual. A paper by Thomas E. Moore, titled Euclid's Algorithm and Lame's Theorem on a Microcomputer, studies the distribution of pairs of integers requiring a fixed number of division counts, or DC, for GCD calculation. A basic program written for Apple II computers was used to prepare such strange and mysterious yet beautiful pictures or screen images. The points M, N are plotted, which have a fixed DC in calculating the GCD of M and N. A four-fold symmetry is achieved because the values of GCD plus minus M, plus minus N are all equal. Looks like some awesome designs were produced. The paper further investigates the patterns obtained. For instance, the first image for DC equals 1 shows that the points M, N plotted are arranged along several lines.
It is clear that the GCD of two integers is obtained in one step, when one of them is a multiple of the other. So if N is equal to K times M for some integer K, then the point M, N lies on the straight line Y is equal to KX. As GCD of N, N is equal to GCD of M, N, the plots are symmetric about the line Y is equal to X. So here the point N, M lies on the line with the slope 1 by K. In the same figure, we observe vertical segments at X values which are multiples of 6. We come across even longer segments for multiples of 12. The example given in the paper is for x equal to 60. The points on the vertical segments correspond to the points 60, plus minus k for k is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6, for which DC, that is the number of division steps, is equal to 1. Note that 60 is the lowest common multiple of all the integers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. And similar vertical segments occur at all x values such that x is the LCM of all the positive integers up to n. The x shape arises due to the points 60 plus minus k, plus minus k for which GCD is obtained in one step. In a similar fashion, various patterns can be found in the other images too.
Another aspect covered in the paper is about the cyclic behavior of division steps for some fixed m greater than or equal to 1, considering all n greater than or equals n. For example, consider this table for m equals 5, 6 and 7. The key observation is that in each case, the values of DC form a cycle of length n. It can be shown that if GCD of m and n is accomplished in, say, S steps by Euclid's algorithm, then GCD of M and N plus KM is also accomplished in S steps for all integers K greater than or equal to 1.
By Euclid's algorithm, we see that in the first step for the GCD calculation of M and N, we get R as the remainder upon dividing N by M. First step for GCD calculation of M and N plus KM also gives us the same remainder R. Thus, in both the cases, the second step and consequently all succeeding division steps are exactly the same. This completes the proof. We had shown that for two consecutive Fibonacci numbers, the maximum number of division steps are used, that is, the upper bound is reached. We showed this for GCD of 8 and 13, which took 5 steps, and due to the result we just proved, it is clear that we can find infinite such pairs of the form 8 and 13 plus 8k, which also take 5 division steps for GCD calculation.
So, I hope that the puzzle pieces are finally falling into place. keep a lookout for our future videos. Click the subscribe button so that you don't miss out. Do it before we take your points off board.